You're listening to the Sheldon McLeod Show on Halifax's number one station for talk radio, News 95.7.
Hosting today is Todd Vino.
Welcome back. Unifor Atlantic Regional Director Lana Payne joins me on the phone. Lana, how are you today?
I'm very well, Todd, and thanks very much for having me.
You got it. So, Northern Pulp, this is a highly controversial topic in the region for a lot of reasons, and impacted by all of that, of course, are real people on all sides of this. But the employees working at Northern Pulp, the 300 employees, they're members of your union, correct?
Yes, most of them are. About 240 members or people who work at the mill are uniform members. The rest are staff and obviously managers and such. But yeah, it's a big group and obviously important jobs to the region, not just in the mill, but in all of those businesses that are connected to that mill, whether it's sawmills or woodlots or you know, in the retail sector, direct and indirect jobs. This mill has quite a large economic footprint, and this is a very worrisome time, as I would say, for our members, but for a lot of other folks in the forest sector.
Okay, so do you feel as though their voice has been properly heard through all of this? What's your take on, from the workers' perspective, the union perspective here?
Yeah, I think what we're seeing is that, you know, we've got this, we're headed towards what's really a major economic crisis in the sector and in a good part of rural communities across Nova Scotia. And it's really not a result, Todd, as we know, of markets or tariffs or anything that's really outside the control of government. It's coming down to what in my opinion, is at political will and whether we're going to see the kind of political leadership required to get a resolution here. And I would say that our members are feeling very squeezed and vulnerable right now. I mean, they've been, this has been incredibly frustrating for them, but also worrisome. And the debate has really been this kind of narrow focus of, you know, jobs or the environment. And I think that that's a false choice. And really, we need to change the conversation and say what it is, what can we do to make sure that we have good jobs at the mill and throughout the forest sector, but also how do we protect the environment? How do we respect First Nations rights? And how do we make sure that fish harvesters have their concerns addressed? And, you know, other jurisdictions across Canada seem to have found the right balance here. And I don't see why we can't do the same thing in Nova Scotia. It, you know, I chat to our members at the mill on a regular basis, and every day, basically, they wake up and they face conflict in their community. This is, as you know, a community now that's very divided. Our members don't know if they're going to have a job at the end of the year. They have people basically lobbying on a daily basis for them to be thrown out of work, including some quite high-profile politicians. You know, their kids are feeling the stress. In some cases, they felt, you know, bullied at school because of where their parents work. And I would say that our members are feeling demonized right now and really caught in the middle of this, what has been a very, very heated debate throughout Pictou County, but throughout the province of Nova Scotia. And I know just talking to one of our sisters this morning, she said, you know, I just feel like my community is being torn apart. And that the divisions are so deep that she worries whether they can ever even be, you know, repaired. And I just think that from, you know, from my point of view, it really is the job of political leaders to do everything possible to kind of mend these divisions, not throw fuel on the fire, which is kind of what we've seen in some cases, but to find a solution that respects, as I say, the rights of First Nations, that protects the environment, and that can save these jobs. And, you know, that might sound like a tough thing to do, but I feel that if you're a premier, your job is to kind of roll up your sleeves and face these kinds of conflicts and these tensions and say, what can we do here? What solution can we find to make sure that we're protecting everybody's interests? And in particular, obviously, from our concern right now, the jobs of our members and the jobs of forest workers throughout the province. I don't think that this is an impossible task, but you need to to have the kind of political leadership, someone who's going to be a catalyst, a mediator, to bring people together and say, you know, what can we do here to fix this problem?
All right, what about those who say it's not just a political problem? The company had 5 years to figure something out and dragged its heels, and they have some ownership over this as well. What's your response to that?
Of course the company has ownership over some of this. I mean, I think that there was a lot that went on in that five-year period, and I think that there's been a lot of work done to try and get ready for what is an application, obviously, that's been made to get an environmental assessment done. But whatever the case may be, whatever occurred in that 5 years, the reality is right now I think one local editorial said we're on a collision course right now. So we are where we are, and it is incumbent on our political leaders to say, okay, what have we got to do here to save the jobs, protect the environment, and make sure our First Nations community, the damage that's been done there is corrected. What I think we've seen instead is, you know, a statement by the premier to say, oh, well, I'm throwing it back on the company and on the community. It's your responsibility to find a resolution here. But the reality is when things are as tense as they have been around this issue, you know, a solution may not be that easy to be found if you're leaving it up to others to do. As a premier, get involved, roll up your sleeves and say, okay, let's sit down and figure out what we can do here. There are a lot of livelihoods counting on, a resolution being found. And I don't think it's good enough just to say, I'm going to throw up my hands and leave it to others to try and figure this out.
Yeah, we're just about out of time, but just to put this into context for everybody, these are not minimum wage jobs, right? These are, obviously, these are well-paying jobs, right?
And this is the other thing, and I think when you look at that, not only are they well-paying jobs in the mill, but the amount of dependency in forestry communities on forestry jobs. There was a study done a couple of years ago that showed that a significant share of household income in the entire community depends on forest sector. They looked at, I think, 600 communities across the country, and 300 of those communities, including some of them from Nova Scotia, we had a 50% minimum household income basically depending on the forest sector in the entire community, 50% of the entire community, and in some cases as high as 30 and 40%. So we're talking about a serious impact, and the future of communities are at risk right now.
Lon, I appreciate your time. Thanks for doing this. We'll talk again.
Thanks very much, Todd. I appreciate it.
You got it. That's Lana Payne, Unifor Atlantic Regional Director. Now it's your opportunity.